while I was sitting and watching this panel, I was a little confused about my presence here today. And then it struck me right at the very end when Mr. Gaurav Gandhi said that content is power. And then I realized, in fact, there should be more people like me who should be part of this process, because as a writer, I always realize that, you know, the two ends of the spectrum are so far apart from each other. Or phir jo humse kaha jata hai ki aise karo, and the audience wants this, or right now, you know, the broadcaster wants this, or the platform wants this. We are actually very far removed from this process. And it's really interesting, and it's really, heartening and widens the horizon to be here, to listen to what is going on at the other end and to implement it. Now, add to it the perceptive burden of being a woman, and then what is that role that we are playing? So first of all, you are in a leadership role and an important role in what I call, you know, the cinematic arts, because it's all over the place, all over the different platforms. So you tell me, Srishti, what is right now, what do you see as the emerging leadership role of women across cinema in whatever forms that one kind of consumes it, and specifically streaming networks?
Push back a little bit and not call it the burden of perception, in fact call it the advantage of perception. Mm. And here as women, it's really important for us to make our voices heard. Half the audience is not represented, half of humankind is not represented, and in all forms of leadership and creative arts, it's very important that our voices are heard right now.
So tell me, as a huge international giant, probably one of the leading networks, streaming networks, if not the largest, do you have, I mean, of course, like we've been hearing, you can't give budgets, you can't give numbers, you can't tell us what the success story and what the success paradigm of a particular show is, but is there some sort of a forward push, an actual model where you have women voices being heard, not just, on screen, but behind the screens?
We just find that on a streaming platform, we have a lot less restrictions compared to the more traditional forms of serving entertainment. And the advantage of, especially on a platform like Netflix, which is so, based so much on the subscriber tastes, and the fact that we can actually serve you some stuff that you really enjoy watching, and we're not stuck. I think an interesting word was used, that it's not broadcast, it's unicast. So we can do individual programming. Mm. And so we just find that we are able to tell a lot more stories and represent a lot more of the people who are actually watching. And women are a very large number of it. I mean, it's just shocking the underrepresentation that we've had behind the camera, stories on the camera of what is a very large part of the viewership.
But tell me something, does the kind of then creating content in that way narrows it down, and does one tend to see it from a very narrow prism? Because that's what happened with television, and when we talked about soaps, it became about, and that was very disparaging to hear, both on as an audience member and as a person who creates this content, that, you know, it is kind of, it is catering to the woman audience, and that's why it is called soaps. I mean, traditionally, okay, this is the women are using the soap and they're watching the soaps. So So tell me something now with the onset of, and now the future is OTT. So when we're talking about women, let me first talk about women representation on screen. How is, what is that kind of, you know, the one line that one is, the network is looking for or asking for in terms of how a woman is portrayed on screen?
I think first and foremost, the most important thing is to find a great story. We want to tell stories that people want to hear. We have the opportunity of not getting restricted down in terms of what we have to say. And what's been fascinating is to see the number of women who've come forward with their stories to be able to say what they want to say. We at Netflix pride ourselves at being creative first. We want people to have their creative voice and vision at all times. A lot of the women have been very forthcoming with their stories. So I wouldn't say that we narrow it down and seek. I think, like you started in the top by saying perception, we do have a lot of women in Netflix in positions of making choices. And so I guess we're more open. to hearing different kinds of stories or identify more with different kinds of stories. But I don't think that women being in power is something that means men not being in power.
Exactly.
Because it's not either or, it's everyone. So it's about wanting to see the representation equalized across.
Yeah, because it was interesting, in this panel, it was like an all-male panel, and I was going through the list of the day's events, and I just did a quick scan. In among the 45 odd speakers or so, I think there were 6 or 7 women, if you even include Anushree in it. So, you know, that is the representation ratio. And I want to ask you a question which I get asked a lot. Why are there such few women lyricists? Or why are there such few women writers? And yes, I do want to applaud Netflix, actually. We have this in-joke that, you know, they have a whole army of women that is in important decision-making leadership positions. So I think that is commendable. But you tell me that why, you answer my question for me.
Well, as far as Netflix is concerned, just like we look for greatest stories, we try and find the most, progressive kind of thinking people to hire. It's not a gender-based decision. It's just that we find that we are getting more and more women coming out with things that we'd like to do, which is also what's happening on the content side. I think we don't have the bias of this may or may not work. Mm-hmm. We don't have that restriction of, oh, it's more likely to do better if it has a male protagonist. Mm-hmm. It's something that's been happening along the way, and we are in the golden age of entertainment right now, and one of the things that makes it so great is the fact that there are all sorts of people represented. It's quite tragic, actually, that diversity, that half the population is considered diverse.
Yeah, absolutely. Now you have these screenwriting programs, which a lot of us use, and they kind of try to insert their diversity, recommendations and comments. And somehow it's very odd when you're absolutely right, when you put it like that, half the population of the world, in fact, I'd say, as far as numbers are concerned, the last census put it, women are a little, ahead of women globally, of men. So anyway, that is the one part of it. Now, tell me, Srishti, coming to the original films that one was talking about, do you think that there is a bias when it comes to cinema, but, feature film, theatrical releases, especially in our country, where you need a kind of a male protagonist to drive a story, even if it is a woman's story, or even if it is a so-called woman-centric story. But you need the face of a big male, I have a comment about the, casual and innocent way of, parlance that Raj said, well, the big boys, you don't need the big boys to make the big hits anymore. So where are the big girls, the big, why is there always a bro code? Even when it comes to a case in point being like a Mission Mangal, you need an Akshay Kumar to kind of, be the face of it. Although it's a story about women who went to Mars.
Women who made it possible to go to Mars. Yeah. But look, they're baby steps. We're coming out of a very, very old and rooted kind of industry. It is not about making a change right to the other end. There's going to be everything. We do have, what's also important is to make sure that there are powerful women characters whenever they are, and they're represented correctly. One of my favorite phrases is casual feminism. Not everything has to be burn the bra. Not everything has to be a woman seeking revenge. But if you have a woman, what does she stand for? I think that's the first level that we need to kind of get to. We don't have those restrictions as far as we're concerned in Netflix about having a male face or anything of the sort. But I think probably traditionally there were more male cinema goers, and for identification you'd go there. Now that you're being served at home and you have access to a lot more women, they would be sampling more. But I think like the success of films like Veera Di Wedding last year would go out to show that there is potential for like a very overtly female film to be watched by all.
Tell me something, that a platform such as yours or big international broadcasters, whether they're OTT or they're in now what are known as the traditional formats, do they perceive the women as a different kind of audience with a different kind of sensibility or a different kind of content to be catered in this, in 2019 with all this talk, are we still seeing men and women as different demographics? well, demographics, yes, but different sensibilities as far as catering of content goes?
A great story is a great story, and that transcends gender, it transcends race, like Gaurav was saying earlier as well, would like travel across countries, and we see that a lot on Netflix and a lot of the shows that we've done in India or in Latin America, which are not necessarily English and therefore the more accessible shows. But of course, there, look, it's as individualistic as an 18-year-old versus a 35-year-old, right? Yeah. So there will be things that we identify with more. There will be things that we want to see more. There are things that we're curious about. And our jobs as content creators and as a platform is to make sure that everybody's needs are served. Mm. We do feel that women are probably underserved, and we could be looking at that as well.
So for example, when you're just taking from, as an example, what you said, when you're talking about an 18-year-old consumer and a 35-year-old consumer, are you thinking of an 18-year-old woman versus an 18-year-old man? And then, I just want to know this for, and there's nothing, I mean, you're absolutely right. Everybody's needs and everybody, every demographic has to be catered for. But is content being viewed or channeled that way?
I don't think we can get so precise on everything. Definitely you want to make sure that there are stories for all the demographics that are available. But at the same time, to try and like get so precise and defeat the creative for the sake of an audience, I think is counterproductive.
Which is good to know, because in any case, what finally works or doesn't work is kind of a mystery, even across, I think, formats, whether it's film or television or now OTT. Would you agree?
Absolutely, but I think there's a connection. Something that's in common is it's a good story, well told, that appeals to a large number of people, depending on the cost that it is made at, I guess. I mean, traditionally, theatrically, that's what you look at. For us, I think, and also going back to something you said earlier, the beauty of the OTT platform is that when something works, although you do feel like there is no direct data shared, people always know when their shows have done well.
In fact, there was something else I wanted to ask you, and not just kind of to make news or headlines, but actually as a creator, I would like to know what is meant by a show being successful. I now understand very well that numbers and things are, they're not put out. And that's kind of complicated and messy as well. But I'd like to understand actually from a leading OTT streaming service point of view, what is the meaning of a successful show?
I would say that a successful show would be the one that has reached its audience and more.
So it's gone beyond its brief. So. Yeah, I'll have to kind of interpret that and then find out, okay, now what do I pitch?
All right. You pitch the story you want to tell. That is what is very important, especially for women, not to think about what people want to hear. And that's the one thing we do, we believe very strongly in Netflix, that we need to hear the story you want to tell. So people oftentimes come to us and tell us that, what do you want to do? Do you have a particular genre? Do you want to do X, Y, Z kind of programming? We want to tell the story you want to tell, because then it comes from a space of conviction and honesty, and we find that more often than not, that is what connects with the subscriber.
That is such a wonderfully organic way of doing it. I mean, I'm very heartened and impressed to hear that, actually. Coming back a little bit to, I think, part of the conversation I heard earlier, because Netflix wasn't represented, I think that's because you were going to be on next, is what I'm assuming. You tell me a bit about this unique model, which actually you guys have invested heavily in, and by invested, I don't mean money, I mean actually time and effort and thought, which is the segment that you are handling, which is original films. And particularly in context with India, just tell us more about that.
India loves films, that's not a secret. We have a lot more film viewing on the service than we have in a lot of other countries. And we see that love for cinema, and we want to cater to everybody and all their needs. It was mentioned earlier on the panel as well, we definitely don't have enough of cinema halls, but we definitely have a huge appetite for film. So it's our job to bring it.
And also, we were talking about half the population being underrepresented in terms of women, but also not everybody gets the chance to be able to tell their stories on cinema. If you have 9,000 odd screens across the country, then I think a lot of the storytellers who've not, and well, the figures are staggering. It would be around 90% of storytellers and content creators who don't get screen space. So this is now, of course, again, now they're baby steps, but do you see this being a kind of a large trend and it picking up, not just Netflix, but everybody following suit?
No, absolutely. Look, the most important thing is always the story that you begin with. Every story has the language that it needs to be told in, not just the language of that's spoken, but also like there are some stories that need to be explored more in character-wise, which need multiple hours to be told. There are some stories that have a beginning, middle, and end. There are some stories that have to be told in fewer hours. So we have the opportunity now, because of streaming services, to be able to tell the story in the form it needs to be told, in the most effective form. And that's about the way to look at it. We do think, seem to think a lot in terms of the three-act structure in a story with the beginning and middle and end. And cinema lends itself to that, and films lend themselves more to that. So we do tend to think a bit like that as Indians. And this is an opportunity to tell the story in the format that you want to.
Do you think films for original films for OTT platforms, do they kind of also take off a bit of the box office burden and then kind of creating, even within the story that you want to tell, a kind of a formula or a template where you are catering to the largest common denominator? So do you think in that sense it will promote kind of a varied and a more diverse and a more unconventional kind of storytelling? Because that's what I'm thinking as a writer.
I think we shouldn't now, at this day and age, be thinking of storytelling as conventional and unconventional. We need to tell all kinds of stories in all kinds of formats, because the opportunity that, especially a platform like Netflix provides, is that should there be any interest, because we don't ask the age or the gender of our subscribers. We are available day and date across in 190 countries. You will not be served as per your language of origin. You will be served as per the taste cluster that you belong to. And if you have interest in similar things, which may be really across and not something that you see, the opportunity for your content to be seen and the opportunity for the subscriber to find the content that they would be interested in is bigger than ever before.
So in a certain way, apart from content being power, and earlier the phrase that one used very often is it's content is king, I'd also say choice is now, individual choice is playing a very important role, and that intimacy of watching, you know, propped on your pillow or, you know, very anywhere else that you'd require. Tell me something, do you think that the way of making films, not just the storytelling, will kind of alter that? Because now, and then the reason why I'm asking this, that I'm kind of now starting to do some work for large OTT platforms, and I keep hearing, especially from the other end of the spectrum, from the marketing side, that, you know, why are we kind of writing this scene this way, or why are we shooting it this way? Because now this is meant primarily to be consumed in a format that is more intimate, and that is more kind of, you know, present, and it's kind of one-on-one. So do you feel that somehow this will also change the way we are filming rather than just telling stories?
I don't think that the model of delivery beyond the points should be influencing the way you want to tell your story. It should be the story. If it's a story that's really intimate, then it needs to be presented that way. If it's a story that's very expansive, it needs to be presented that way. And like they were discussing earlier on this panel as well, the screen that you're watching on is no longer restricted, you know, either just to the mobile phone or just to the silver screen. And people are consuming films on Netflix or series on Netflix across various sizes. So I don't think we need to restrict our thinking in terms of making basis what we perceive the option will be to see it.
Do you see the reverse happening? Original films that are made for OTT getting theatrical releases, do you think somewhere down the line that could become a model?
Well, why not? I mean, look, whatever it is that brings the maximum subscriber joy is what we should be doing.
And that, like it was being said earlier, that that's how these partnerships evolve. So whatever model works that... Do you watch a lot of content apart from what's on your platform?
I would love to say I do, but there isn't like enough of time. And there's just some fantastic work being done across platforms. Mm. Ours is better.
Okay, so what was the last show you watched?
Last show I actually watched was I binged Mindhunter.
Okay.
Because it's a favorite of mine, and the first season I watched when I was outside of Netflix, mm-hmm. and now to watch it inside and to actually know, you know, how these things are put together, it's been fascinating. It's the bell.
Yeah. So I think that means we need to go to the audience. Oh, that's better. All right. We got a more harmonious one.
This is Yuvraj Kumar. So I've studied my filmmaking from Whistling Woods International, and I'm an independent filmmaker. So 2017 was the time my film was ready to be released, and we got a limited release because of the screen problems. The film is titled ISIS, Enemies of Humanity. I was the producer and the director. What happened was, I built my own platform, you know, for people to watch the movie. It's called ISISthefilm.com. So I'm here for that, you know, like, how do I take this platform? It just has one film, and it's unlocked for the rest of the world, but not India, for which I'm charging $10 per view. So what would you suggest, you know, out of your experience, because such a big platform you have?
I would suggest that we take this offline, because it's a really long conversation.
Anything specific for Srishti and Netflix?
Hi, my name is Dharmendra Rai. Two quick questions. One is, how do you intend to compete against Amazon? Because that's a giant company and it's proved that it can get access to a lot of capital without the need to produce profits fast. And number two, how will a series like Sacred Games or Mindhunter even exist if it's subject to censorship?
Wow, that's two like really long questions. I think the idea is not to, like everybody else was saying earlier as well, we are all complementary right now. We are creating an awareness for a potential service. And we are all like kind of supporting each other and making sure that there is an awareness growing about this other form, the streaming form of content receiving. And all we need to do is to do our best that we can. We are always thinking about our consumer first at Netflix and not really about what everybody else is doing, because that's not really going to make us get more people.
About the censorship thing? It's in the news yesterday.
I haven't seen that. I've heard about this, but we are currently engaged with a lot of the, our other streaming, co-streamers, and we have a self-regulation that we have all come in for, and let's see how things unfold.
All right, I've just been told that time's up, but give it up for both the ladies and gentlemen. Like I said, the epitome of Nari Shakti. All right, can I have Anushree? Thank you so much for being with us.